So what are we discussing? The output impedance, input impedance, and the impedance matching. What advantage I have with CMOS? CMOS will be connected through low resistance path of PFET to VDD when it is at logic 1. When it is at logic 0, I have the same thing connected to the ground through the conducting NMOS. Right? You remember this all bits. Now, this. And what is this? A buffer. Each stage of CMOS, I give this input, I take this output and give it as input to the next stage and take it as output. And whenever I say you have high fan out, that means from this node or from this node, I take more than one gate connection. Whatever be the number of gates which are connected with it, I call it as the fan out. What is going to be fan in? Whatever be the number of inputs what I get at this junction as the input, they are called the fan in. Why the fan in and fan out are so really important, and how the low output impedance of CMOS circuits are advantages. What did I say here? This happens to be a very low resistance path. So, even if you have some n number of gates connected here, you are able to go for operating those gates, theoretically speaking. But as I said, you are going to have some kilo ohms of resistance, channel resistance. That means what is it? Whenever I study inverter, I give a 0 here, I get a 1, that 1 is given here, and I get a 0. Just zeros and ones transitions are not enough. How fast this 0 to 1, 1 to 0 are going to be happening? They are going to be important also. The resistance of these parts are not going to be theoretically 0. I would want to have 0 resistance so I can make the transistor very wide. If W is so much, the current is directly proportional to W and inversely proportional to L. So, it's the other way for the resistance. I can make it very wide. But what will happen if I make this transistor bit very wide? This W, L into C aux is going to be the gate capacitance for this node, output capacitance. So, bigger the driver transistor, the driven transistor, more would be the load. More would be the load for it. I can make this very thin. If I make this very thin, this CG is going to be reduced. But what will increase? The resistance here will increase, right? So we have got to always go for optimal sizing. Why I say optimal? Optimality between what factors? The fan out current and the transient response. Why the transient response is so important? You see, I am connecting a big CG here with a number of fan out gates I have connected. So, n times CG I have, and I have a certain resistance. So, it is an RC. What is RC time constant for this? For raising from 0 to 1. N times R into CG. Higher the fan out, more would be the time. So it will not go like this, rather it would go very slow like this. It may even go slow, so slow. If I have very less fan out, I will try to go for raising up immediately. And similarly, I now have this node going down to from 1 to 0. Whenever I say in CMOS, I am getting the output node as 0. What does that mean? I am getting rid of whatever charges I have across the load capacitances. But where will the charge go? To the ground, of course. But through what path? Through the conducting N path. And once again, the same case holds here. If I make this very wide, the current will go very fast, charge will get reduced very fast. But if I make it very narrow, it would be going very slow, my time would be very high. And if I make it very big, then your CG here would be increasing. Therefore, the transient response is going to be such an important one. We studied last time about the rise time, fall time, and the delay characteristics. They are now going to be dependent on the sizing of your CMOS device. But you have got to know something else also here. I said, if you give a 0, this is a 1. For 1, it will be a 0. That means, if I am going to give an input like this, exactly like this, I expect. But as I said, if my fan out is going to be so low, this will not go down 0 immediately. It may take even this much amount of time. By the time it can reach 0, what has happened to the input? It has gone low. Therefore, this transition would be rather like this. Then am I having good response at the output? Correct transient response? No. That is the reason why the voltage, the time period, and the load capacitances, the sizing of devices, or in other words, the technology, all are proving dependency against each other. We cannot irrationally go for thinking that I can go for any frequency. By the time I go for responding, here what happens? The input state changes. All these characteristics are going to be so interdependent. Understand? Therefore, I should go for having tolerably lower fall time. And at this point, when I go for getting reduced level here, I will go for having performance like this. So it can be like this. It is tolerable. The maximum tolerable is going to be this way. At least the amplitude reaches. Another advantage of your CMOS is it is a ratio-less circuit. What do you mean by ratio-less circuit? I now said, with respect to your input changes, my output would be changing like this and all that. And also I said, if my fan out is so high, I may not go for having this level reached at all. Imagine I go for giving such a voltage and my circuit in response, my output goes like this. It is taking from here so much time really to reach the 0 volt level. But it has reached the 0 level. It cannot go for avoiding the 0 level at any point of time. It cannot stop coming itself to 0. Similarly, when I go for giving a high to a low, after some point, compulsorily it has to come to the VDD level. Because why? I have the charging path, current will go on flowing, right? Till this point also becomes VDD. And similarly, as long as this transistor is on, completely this charge, completely whatever I had across the capacitance will go to ground. In steady state, the output can either be 1 or in 0 only. Now I give you some assignment problems. Go for referring to the other type of, before 1980s and all, you had only NMOS devices to be forming the basic structure, the leaf cell of all the digital circuit design. Only later we went for getting the CMOS into picture, 80s, right? Now you identify what are the other type of inverters. I called the CMOS device as what? Ratio-less. Ratioed inverters. What are they? Their types. Go for studying about them and go for taking some hints about those circuits in your notebook. Leave some two, three sheets of paper, and in those three sheets of paper, identify what are the type of inverters you have, okay, ratioed type of inverters, and have it prepared, okay. Now we will continue. Whenever I want to do the timing analysis with the first order DC analysis circuit, how am I going to consider the inverter? If PMOS device is off, it is open, and NMOS device is on. That means what? I am giving Vin a logic 1 level. If I am giving a logic 1 level, the bottom transistor is on, and the theoretical zero resistance I cannot consider. It has, with respect to its own length and width, a certain resistance, Rn. You can pull a chair and come here. You. And a table also. And similarly for the other case, if Vin is at a zero logic, 0 volts, then what happens? I have my NFET off because I am having less than VTN. Therefore, this transistor is not on. Whereas with low voltage, the other thing is on and I have a certain resistance. Therefore, the VM, the switching threshold, how the switching happens is going to be based on the Rn and Rm, Rp. And this Rn and Rp, I call this a switching threshold, what it is, we will see. So far, we have been introduced to what? VTN, threshold voltage of N device, threshold voltage of T device. Now, I am going to be talking about the switching threshold of the inverter. Why is it necessary? I have an input signal going like this. I get my output supposed to be this way. So, whenever I give this, what is going to be the middle point, which is going to be making the midpoint of the output transition also, the switching threshold. We will see that. Why it is important also, we will discuss. So far, whatever we have been studying, GIST, CMOS properties, full rail to rail swing. What do you mean by rail to rail? VDD is one rail, ground is another rail. The swing is going to be, as I told you, in the case of ratioed inverters, you are not going to have rail to rail swing. Either the VDD minus VT drop would be there, or VDD to VTP or VTN will be there. Okay, either the zero level will be affected, or the N level will be affected, or both will be affected. Now, shall I ask you a simple question? So far, we have been studying about the PMOS connected at the top and NMOS connected at the bottom. Right? I now want to make a change. I want to connect a N device at the top, P device at the bottom. And I go for giving an input. What will happen to this circuit? What will be the voltage output be like? You would want to simulate and see? Simulate and see. Okay? Simulate and come tomorrow. Any spice? How many of you in your laptops have got any spice? Sorry, okay, I'll ask this way. Who is not having any spice in your laptop? You. You're having. All of you are having. Just an inverter. Okay? Try it and let me know. Then I will talk to you about something else. So the full rail to rail swing. If I have full rail to rail swing, high noise margins are going to be there. Because this is very important. Noise margin is very important. Why? For lower technology nodes, what do? We have our VDD and ground levels denoted by very low voltage span. Even if I go for 0.9 volt, the threshold voltage is around 0.3 and all. If I go for having my 0.3x threshold voltage, that means what? I am going to be having my noise margin curtailed. Previously, what would be the ratio of my supply voltage to threshold voltage? I was operating with 5 volts supply and 1 volt threshold voltage, and it was 1:5 ratio, and I had a very safe operation. Even if the voltage goes to even 2 volts, I can very comfortably say 1.5, 1.8 volts, I can very comfortably say it is a 0 level. So anything around 0.7, 0.8 also can overlap. I will still not identify that as a logic 1 state wrongly. And similarly, this 5 can come down to even 3.5 volts. I can safely say it is a logic 1 level, because I had so much of leverage, moving space. I don't have it now. I don't have any more the 1:5 threshold voltage to supply voltage ratio. This happens to be a very big problem. And imagine if I am not using CMOS, I have been using some other inverter, purely using NMOS inverters. Then what will happen? My level itself will be affected. Already the level 0 to VDD is so low, and one VT also is done with. Then what will happen? I am not going to have a good circuit which is tolerable to any noise. Okay, very ambiguous it would be. Therefore, and these points, whatever we had been discussing, I show you, I want you to go for why these CMOS are called ratio-less gates. Want you to look into them, whatever we have discussed now, remember everything. There is always a path from VDD to ground, VDD to ground up, VDD to output, or ground to output. If I have a path, what I said, can it happen theoretically? Can I have a direct path from supply to ground? I can never have. Because if it is 0, only this is on. If it is 1, only this is on. At no point of time, theoretically speaking, I'll have both to be on. Therefore, theoretically speaking, once again, I am not going to have any rail to rail current. That is short circuit. Short circuit current. Okay. Now, we will, however, elaborate that later. Whatever I said now would be proved wrong in practice. How? We will see that. And extremely high input resistance we have stopped, and extremely low output impedance also, and propagation delay. The response, the circuit time response, is going to be based on the load capacitance and the transistor resistance. What transistor resistance? P FET while charging high, N FET while charging low. So if I have fan out of very, very high numbers, then what will happen? My C would be very high, RC therefore would be very long. Time constant would be very high. So this is how we are going to be studying the transient response. So the time constant would be RP times CL when it is charging from low to high. When it is going from 1 to 0, it is going to be RN times CL. Here it is going to be RP times CL. So always a function of load capacitance and the resistance of the charging part. Now instead of an inverter, imagine I have got an AND gate structure, a NAND structure. Then I, instead of having only one resistance here, I will have another. Assume I have got A dot B. Then what I will have here, one transistor in series with another transistor. I will show like this itself. One transistor, another transistor in series. And as we said, it is a complementary structure. So, I will have like this. I have my AB connected here. That means what? If I have my A low, then this is going to be on. If I have my B also low, this is going to be on. If I have my A high and B also high, I will have both these conducting. Correct? Even at this point itself, we will discuss that, because anyway, we have got to be discussing about them later in detail. So it will give you input even now. For different cases, let me take A is equal to B is equal to 1. This is my output. A is equal to B is equal to 1. What does that mean? This is on and this is on. It is one RN here, another RN here. Assume at this point I have CG, load capacitance. That also is not going to be constant. Why? We will see later. So CG times 2RN will be the 1 to 0 time. Now I have A to be 1, B to be 0. This is on, but this is off. So it will not go for discharging. Instead, what will happen? B is 0, therefore this would be on, this would be off. Therefore, I have what now? 1RP times CG to be the time constant factor. Now you imagine both A and B are 0. Then this would be on and this also would be on. Previously it was RP times CG. Now it is going to be RP by 2 times CG. Resistance is going to be half. They are in parallel paths. Two parallel paths are there. Yes or no? Therefore, the time constant, see, previously if it had gone like this, now it is going to be going faster. I can otherwise show this as example. Previously it was this, now it is this, faster. So like that, I would have, based on the logic states of inputs, whether they are zeros or ones, I will have the resistances varying and even capacitances varying. How the capacitances are going to be varying, the CG is going to vary, that you will tell me later. You have in your tools, who was using Tanner? You have list all parameter. During simulation, you can always give a comment. What was that? The comment list all or dot list. Even in cadence, it should be there. Pentagraphics, it's there. When you put such a comment, what the comment will do? It will get the circuit identified for each and every nodal capacitance also identified. Then you have to understand. We will have some examples also on it. Whatever work I am giving you, you have got to note it down in the notebook at that point itself. Work it out in the same day evening. If you want to do, only if you study that way, it would be good. Remember. So, low to high and high to low transitions, how would they happen? And steady state response, we said. Now we go for the voltage transfer characteristics of CMOS. This is again going to be very important, how the input creates the change in the output. And we are using what? PMOS device, and we are using NMOS device. Because in the inverter, I am using both NMOS and CMOS, I should take into account the characteristic response of both the NMOS and also the PMOS. And I am going to be operating only with the voltages 0 level and VDD. Therefore, it is good if I bring this region and this region overlapping against each other. I am not giving any negative voltage. See, I am giving a minus VDD here. Am I giving a minus VDD there? No. Instead, what I do? Here I am making the source at ground and making the drain at VDD. Whereas, for the PMOS, what I do? I go for making the source at VDD, the drain at ground. Therefore, I can, as it is, flip it over. Flip once vertically, then horizontally. I can overlap against each other. But there is only one issue. What issue? The beta values, the transconductance values of both are not the same because the mobilities are not the same. In order to compensate that, normally, what do? We make the PMOS wider than your NMOS. By whatever times your mobility for your electrons is more than your PMOS, that much bigger you increase the width or length, width of your PMOS device. So the PMOS load line. So we see the load lines of PMOS and the NMOS. I said I want to bring it overlapping against each other. Now what is, if I have the inverter drawn like this, I have my VDD, here I have my G, so V, G, S, P, here I have my VGS, N, this is my V out. If I have my V in applied here at this point, I have my VDD, right? My V gate to source of P is equal to what? V in, this is the voltage, minus VDD, because this is the source. VGSP is what? V in minus VDD. Similarly, for NFET, how do I say? This is going to be your V and this is your S. I have my VGSN applied here. So this is V in minus 0. And this is going to be what at this output node? I have my V output, I have my drain, I have my source. V out minus VDS is going to be at the output side. For the input side, V in, right? Is going to be minus VDD would be VGSP. I can say it this way also. Right? Why I say that like that? From here, VIN is equal to VDD plus VGSP. And IDN is what? If I look at the inverter, whatever current I have here, I have in the opposite direction through N, flowing down to ground. Therefore, IDN, the direction of your charge, hole flow from top to bottom, electron flow from bottom to top. So, IDN is going to be minus IDP also. Therefore, V out, as I showed you, yeah, what is V out in your, this is your V, yes, VDD. What is your V out? V out is equal to VDD plus whatever voltage drop I have across your V drain to source. So VDD plus VDSP. These are the important points. This happens to be the response with respect to input and output of your PMOS device. Now what I do? I know IDN is equal to minus IDP. I assume beta N is equal to beta P. I have made the beta, the P type device wider enough so that I get beta N is equal to beta P. Now since IDN is equal to IDP, I flip this over up. Flip it up. If I flip it up, this is going to come like this. And similarly, what I now do? I do not have a minus VDD. As I said, instead of keeping source at low and drain at minus VDD to collect the holes, I am keeping source at a plus VDD so that they source holes, and drain I am keeping at low. I supply the voltage that way. Therefore, I once again flip it vertical. This is it. V out is equal to VDD plus VDSP, and I got. Over this, what do I have for my NMOS devices? And what do I now have for my PMOS devices? That's all. So I bring them both together to study the voltage variation what I give. Because I give my V in to the shorted gate terminals of PMOS and NMOS. So in the same figure only I should see, to see the collective load line. What is load line? As input changes for the inverter, how the output responds? I should know. So I am actually arriving at the load line characteristics of the total CMOS inverter. I have now superimposed. These green are for the NMOS. These red are for the PMOS. So I need to identify for each input zero voltage for PMOS, zero voltage for NMOS. What is the common intersecting line? I identify points, then I join all those points together to create the common load line for the inverter as it is. Okay, CMOS inverter transient characteristics. Sorry, input output characteristics. How do I do? What is first? 0 volt. Where is the 0 volt line of PMOS? Here it is starting. This is PMOS 0 volt. What is NMOS 0 volt? Here it is. Okay. Then what is the next point? Vin is 0.5. I have my green Vin of 0.5 here. Vin 0 is the same line. I got this point, first 0, first point. Then what I have? Vin of 0.5 here. And here I have this Vin for my PFET, the intersecting point I identify. And then for my 1 volt Vin, and for here a 1 volt line, where do they intersect? At this point. Okay, this is the point. And then I have my 1.5 Vin line. And here it is 1.5 line. This is the point. Similarly, a 2 volt line here. And for the PMOS device, the 2 volt line. Intersecting point. So these points I collect. I identify for each Vin point. What is the V out? I identified. Now we go for, that is the load line points I identified, and I connect all of them together. I get such that is zero input voltage. For that, the output is what? 2.5. Then what is the next input voltage? 0.5 for this here, 2.3 something. Then for 1 volt, it is 2 point something. And then this point for V in around 0.3, I have V out of so much. V in 1.5, I have V out so much. And then V in of 2 volts, V output of so less. V in of 2.5, I have output of 0. All these points, I brought it here. So V in, first point, second point, third point, connect everything. This point and this point, I joined. And as we know, these are the points where my gain is going to be equal to minus 1. And in between, I have an area where you have the maximum gain. Now, I should identify for each of these regions. How do I say about these regions? The A region is where you have the input voltage rising and reaching VTM. That means what? Till this point is reached, until this point is reached, I don't have my NMOS on. So at only at this point my NFET is becoming on, and after that N is remaining on. And it would go on be on condition. But what about the saturation or linear region of operation? We need to identify whether it is operating in linear or saturation is dependent on what? What is its VDS voltage, drain to source voltage, in relation with your VGS minus VT. What is VGS minus VT? Vin minus VT. VGS is nothing but Vin minus VT. In comparison, between what? Drain to source voltage and gate to source voltage minus VT, I am going to be having the operation in either the linear region or in saturation region. When VDS is equal to or more than VGS minus VT, I am going to be having them in saturation. You know that. And that is going to be for NMOS and also for PMOS. When I say VTN is the minimum voltage I need to push the NMOS on, the PMOS would be on during all these times. When will it be off? The moment the voltage difference between its gate and source is less than in this region. What is happening? This is VDD, this is VDD minus VTP. If the voltage difference is less than the threshold voltage, then what happens? PFET would be off. Therefore, very easily we can identify the A region where your NFET is off, the E region where you have your PFET off. In between, I should check which is in linear region and which is in saturation region. I now take my inverter at this point itself. This is my V out. And Vin. I have VTN here, VTP there. Now this is V out, my drain to source and drain to source. At this point, I say it is cut off. Right, agreed. After VTN is reached, beyond that, what is my V input? The NFET is on. NFET is on, therefore I have a certain voltage V out here, and how much is the voltage V out? This amplitude. I am giving input here and I am just going into this region. This is of this value maximum, whereas this is of this value. So which is bigger? V out to ground is bigger. So, it is in saturation. Point C region, there also I have my output maybe around VDD by 2, whereas my input is also VDD by 2. VDD by 2 minus VT, that would be less. Therefore, it keeps itself in saturation only. And beyond that, my input is going to be so much, whereas my output has become so low, therefore VDS is lower than VGS minus VT. Therefore, I have Pakka channel, I have the linear region of operation for NMOS. And even beyond that, this input is now going to be so high, and VDS is going to be only so much, V out minus ground, and now I comfortably have the linear region of operation. You look at the same way for the PMOS device. When it was in B region, what happens? Output so much was there across the NFET. This VDS was more. This VDS plus this VDS is the total VDD. Now I have my output V out, and this output minus VDD, if I take, what will be there? This is drain to source. This V out is going to be so big, and this is going to be nearly VDD. Therefore, I am not going to be having that in saturation. Rather, it is in linear region. The next region also. When I am having this in linear region, my output is going to be so low, and I am going to be having this difference across my drain to source of my PFET only. Therefore, that VDS is going to be bigger, definitely more than VGSP minus VT. Therefore, the PMOS enters into saturation and saturation. Finally, it gets cut off when this difference between drain and gate, source and gate, is no longer more than the threshold voltage, sufficient enough to drive it on. Now, about each of these regions, I hope you have understood why we have taken only an inverter, because I am taking one input connected with both NMOS and PMOS, and I am taking one V out point, that is the drain point of both the terminals. So, drain to source and drain to source, I check in comparison whether they are in linear region or a saturation region or in cutoff, we discussed. This in elaboration, the next few slides, region A, you can go through them. When Vin is 0, output is VDD. Once it starts conducting in the next region, you have VGSN is more than VTN, so transistor becomes on and it directly goes into saturation. Why? Because of this condition. PMOS is still on because it has sufficient threshold voltage. And it is in linear region because its VDS is not more than VGS minus VT. Similarly, the region C, wherein both are in saturation. Because the drain to source voltage of P and drain to source voltage of N, both are more than its their own VGS minus VT. And the next region of D, the last region E, where PMOS is off. Therefore, the CMOS inverter voltage, input output voltage transfer characteristics are determined like this. The exact center point, what I get here, is the threshold voltage of inverter. What we call this? Inverter threshold. This is not the device threshold. It is the inverter threshold. Why we say inverter threshold? What is the point at which? The center point at which we can assume that the input states will change. Output states also will change. Exactly, theoretically and even practically, you can attain that to be VM point exactly at VDD by 2. This is an ideal inverter. But we can go far based on the application changing the inverter threshold. How do I change the inverter threshold? Either I can take this characteristics, follow this line. Then what do I mean? Voltage noise margins I am changing. I am giving a big low level noise margin. And I am reducing the noise margin for my high level. I can either make like this Or I can make this way also. So exactly V out by 2 is reached here. Whereas for this circuit, it is exactly at this point. Whereas here, I can take this around. So for what applications you would want? Based on this, what else changes? The race time, fall time will change. Race time and fall time. How? Take this graph. What does that mean? The output high to low transition is happening very fast. So out of the pull up network and pull down, what is pull up and pull down network? NMOS devices make the output to be brought low. So it is pull down network, PDN. Whereas your PMOS networks, what do? They pull it up when they conduct. Therefore, we call this as pull up network. Now you tell me, when this high to low reaches very fast, what does that mean? The pull down network is fast. That means I have good pull down network, efficient, more efficient pull down network, less efficient pull up. Right? And if I look at this, the third graph. Third graph, what happens? I am going actually input, I am giving so much, only then the transition is trying to happen. That is, the circuit would want to stick to the high level itself for a longer time. Therefore, I can go for changing, tinkering the high level noise margin and the low level noise margin. Thereby, I can go for better race time characteristics for my circuit. My circuits wherein I want to have very short race time, or my circuits where I want to have very quick fall time characteristics. Because you may have some circuits may be low active, some circuits may be high active. You go for giving your escape button, I press. When I press the escape button, what normally we give? Low active, right? I may want to give at some points high active. Whether the low triggering edge is important or high going triggering edge is important. The strobing, which point you would want to have? Negative clocked triggering or positive clocked triggering? You may want to have. So all such ideas are getting really accomplished by understanding these principles. Okay. These are very important. So what do we call it? Beta P by beta N. I said, more to the right you go, more efficient are the PMOS devices, I said. That means what? If I say they are more efficient, what do I really mean? The W of those devices are big. So beta P by beta N is 10. Beta P is 10 times more than beta N. Whereas here beta N is 10 times more than your beta P. That means what? The N mass pull down network is more powerful. Here P mass network is more powerful. At the center point, both are equally powerful. That means beta P by beta N is 1. Equal aspect ratio. Okay. These gates, whether you push it to the extreme right or extreme left, you are literally skewing. It is not in normal form. This is therefore called skewed gates. Okay. The beta ratio. So the switching threshold as a function of WP by WN or your beta P by beta N. How the switching threshold changes. Now we have not talked about the noise margin set we will go. So if I want to calculate the inverter threshold voltage Vm, how do I find it out? I know my ID of N device is going to be equal to I drain of PMOS device. They are going to be equal, I know. And if I consider my device to be operating in linear region, both the devices in linear region, theoretically speaking, Rabe considers this. In region C, both are in saturation. Correct? In region A and B, A is off, E is off, cleavage. N is off and P is off. Right? And your P region, P device, we had the toggler column. Remember this always. I had my saturation in these two regions. And during the C region, both are in saturation. Whereas here, this is in linear, linear, and linear, and linear. At no point of time, we can theoretically consider both to be in linear region. So, for characterizing the inverter circuit, Rabe is solving this. This current equation, what I have assumed, lower technology nodes. It is not the square law equation. Right? What do I now have? The first order equation, whatever we have studied already, what you have studied already. The current of your NMOS device is equivalent to the opposite direction current of your PMOS device. From here, I can solve for Vm. And it comes to like this. My Kp, Kn values. When I consider both the devices to be in linear region. Now I go for considering the devices in saturation region. In region C. What is the current of NMOS device and that of PMOS device? Equate, and from here, assuming beta n is equal to beta p and bt n is equal to minus vtp, I identify exactly at vdt by 2 point I have. So, by device sizing beta p and beta n, I can go for identifying the switching threshold of our inverters. These are all from Rabe only. Okay. My now duty is this being my threshold of my switching inverter, what is going to be the noise margin? What liberty do we have with respect to the noise margins? Up till this point, my NFET is not on. My NFET is becoming on. And I have, this is a piecewise linear character converted from the original figure, from the original input-output VDC. Right? From here to here, it needs so much of voltage change. Input change, and this is the output change. So the gain G is going to be what? This output change divided by the input change. VIH minus VIL is going to be. And why it is negative? Because as one raises, the other one falls down. Okay. When input raises, the output falls down. So negative gain. Inverter it is. So VIH minus VIL is equal to VOH minus VOL by G. What is VOH in CMOS? VDD. It can be nothing else. It can be nothing else. And this VOL is always zero. For NMOS inverters or quasi, you will have different levels. whereas here we are taking only CMOS inverter. Therefore, VDD is going to be your VOH, VOL is always 0. Therefore, this difference is minus VDD by G. Now, what is VIH? Whatever be the center point I have here, Vm minus this value is your VIH. What is your VIL? This Vm plus whatever I have here, VDD minus Vm by G. Because it is the output response when I am having the change got here. So VIH and VIL we identify. Now what is noise margin H? High noise margin. Any voltage whatever I give here is going to be termed as high input. So any noise can go for contributing to this level. What is going to be the noise margin low level? From here, 0, any value up till this point, I can consider them to be the noise. So I have sufficient enough noise margins on either side. If my inverter is so bad that I have like this, maybe then what about the noise margin in this case? When I calculate this VIH and VIL, I would be bringing this VIH here and I would be bringing my VIL here. But when will this sort of a thing be happening? When will this sort of a thing be happening? When I keep the threshold voltage to be so low. If I keep my VTN so low and VTP to be so very less, then I have the noise margins also affected. Can I afford to have that? I cannot. Another reason would be very high leakage and all that. Practically looking at this, this is another big advantage. For your understanding only, I tell you this. Already we are running short of the supply voltage. Correct? We are not able to give sufficiently high voltage. If we are reducing the threshold voltage to so much less, you will study later. The leakage current, the leakage power is going to be so high. Static power dissipation without any switching. We of course allow the circuits to dissipate power when switching happens. That is dynamic power. Unnecessarily, if my threshold is so low because of some noise, if it becomes on and gets the current leaking, what will happen? Unnecessary power dissipation. So this puts a limit on the low threshold, low voltage threshold circuits, low VTH. There are circuits which will operate with high VTH. There are circuits which operate with low VTH circuits. Yesterday I talked about multi-threshold. Dual threshold or multi-threshold, dynamically varying threshold. I cannot go for reducing the threshold so badly. If I go for reducing, the noise margin will be affected and the leakage power also will be bad. But if I keep high VI threshold, if I keep high threshold, the same curve will become, the same performance will become high. Like this. And then I am going to be having still wider high noise margin and still broader low noise margin. Instead of this point, I am going to take it up to even this point. Okay, but at no point of time I want these two. I cannot allow these two to overlap. Can I overlap? No. I can never have this performance also. I will always look at this practical performance only. Exactly at VDD by 2, if I make my switching threshold for my NMOS device and PMOS device also, my performance theoretically will be like this. Understand? Exactly at VDD by 2. This also is practically not allowable. The moment my voltage reaches from VDD by 2 to slightly some millivolts up or slightly some millivolts down, the devices will fight against each other to get switched on. So I should have the high transition region, the high to low transition region wider to some extent. I cannot make it narrower. I cannot make the noise margin low, low also. I cannot make the noise margin high also very low. All these constraints you will go for taking while designing digital circuits. I am now taking only an inverter. It can be any combinational gate, any Boolean function. I could go for having in the complementary PMOS and NMOS pull down and pull up networks. The same approach, whatever we are showing for the inverter, will hold good for all the circuits. This is a fundamental circuit, what you will have. This is actually a simulated one using Tanner. I am going to show you something. If I am having my VTC received like this, the gain, if I want to calculate what maximum gain value, this is my minus 1 and minus 1 I said, this is the point what is shown there. This is the high gain region between VIL and VIH, high gain region. This is the gain value, which is useful for your analog, which is useful for your digital. So we are not wasting any region of operation of your MOS devices. We cannot afford to. So fully we are exploiting. As a function of VDD, I just simulated this, just for showing to the students what I had my 2.5 volts power supply for the same technology, that is 250 nanometer. I went for 1.5 volt, 0.5 volt, and even further down. The inversion happened even to this point. But naturally, this performance is not there. If I have this sort of a thing, what would be the noise margin? As I said earlier, it would be very bad. Okay? And I don't have much of digital region of operation to satisfactorily work. Therefore, there is a limit of voltage above which only you will go for working with the digital circuits also for a certain technology. You cannot try operating your 90 nanometer device with microvolts of VDD. Sub-threshold region of operation you work, but there you will have this sort of operations only. So you need to take care. The speed you cannot achieve. With high enough voltage you are able to achieve low to high, high to low transitions. Whereas in sub-threshold you always go for working where power is of the main concern, where you don't have the operating speed majorly affecting your circuit, your system. That is why sub-threshold or near-threshold circuits will always be working in lower frequency ranges only. Only where it is necessary that you bring down the power, where you are not bothered about speed performance. So what about the process parameter variations? As I said, right side you go, good PMOS, left side you go, good NMOS. And the process parameter variations, what do I mean by that? My doping can take effect, my temperature can go for taking effect, my design conditions may go for varying, environmental conditions, moisture, everything will go mattering. And the next topic is about your propagation. Go for taking it tomorrow.